أنت الحبيب المصطفى، أنت الأمين، يا خير خلق الله خير المرسلين.
إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء.
الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. We see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a risala, يعني with a message, as al-rahma, rahmatul lil-alameen, يعني a mercy to all of al-alameen, to all of the worlds, all of the creation. That's why you see many of even the non-Muslims that lived under the Muslim Khilafah, they realized this. And you will see through history that, for example, when Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, one of the great a'imma of Islam, when he died in Baghdad, when they were having his janazah, the Christians and Jews that lived peacefully in Baghdad with the Muslims, they came. And they said, because of this man, we were living in peace. Yani Allah put barakat and Allah put blessings upon the land, even though they weren't Muslim, but they realized that Islam is a mercy to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with this mercy for all of mankind. And he loved to bring peace. He loved to bring unity. He loved to live in an environment where people can get to know their Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala without partisanship and without being at war with each other. And that's why when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Medina, and that's where we are, in the first year of Hijri, yani after the Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is the first thing he did? He brought peace. He stopped the civil war between Aus and Khazraj. And he made peace treaties with the Yahud, with the Jews that were living in Medina, to have peace between the Muslims and Jews in Medina, to protect Medina from every side. But as we've been discussing, the Quraysh and the Mushrikeen, they didn't leave the Muslims alone. They kept attacking the Muslims. And now, in this stage, what did they do? They started to take the wealth of the Muslims that was left in Mecca. As we mentioned, the people who made Hijrah, they left everything. They left for the sake of Allah, sometimes under the cover of night, sometimes under false pretense of going somewhere else, sometimes in prison, and then they would escape. So they left everything. They had houses, they had money, they had wealth, they had children, they had families, they had land, they had properties, they had trade goods. You know, the people of Mecca, they were traders. They were farmers. So all the merchandise they had, they left behind in Mecca. And the Quraysh, what did they start to do? They started taking that merchandise and selling it in Sham, and taking it to Yemen, and taking it to places and selling it, taunting the Muslims that were taking your wealth. It's being sold, you can't do anything. But the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba, they were patient. But patience has a limit. Patience has a limit. Because unfortunately, human nature is such that when you allow somebody to continuously violate you, continuously, as they would say in America, punk you, then people don't react respectfully. Then they think you're weak, and then they want to take advantage of you even more. So here, at a time where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was being patient, and the Sahaba, even though they were strong men like Hamza and Umar and Ali, and very strong people, strong personalities, warriors, but for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the sake of spreading peace on earth, they were being patient. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them permission. أُذِنَ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ SubhanAllah. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? We gave permission. أُذِنَ يعني أذن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو للذين تدور يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا يعني because they are being oppressed. Who is fighting them? They're making ظلم upon them. the Quraysh, they were doing zulm. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gave them the permission to defend themselves. Now here, the Sahaba still don't have permission for full out battle. But enough is enough. They've been given permission to defend themselves against those that are oppressing them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he decided to now put some pressure on the Quraysh. Now look at this. Even at this time, where the Quraysh, their caravan, taking, stealing the Muslim merchandise from Mecca, going to Sham, is crossing Medina. It's going past Medina. But even then, the Prophet ﷺ didn't allow the Sahaba to raid them, to take back what's theirs. Instead, he told them to go out and just put pressure on them. And he showed them that we are here, and we can defend ourselves, and just give them enough of a pressure that they stop their dhulm. That's all the Muslim wants, stop their dhulm. So here, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he started to send out expeditions. Now, it's very important for us to know about battles and the names and how they affect how we understand them. And I want to explain something before we go further. This is all from the istilah or the technical terminology of the ulama of tariq, of the ulama of history. This is not to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called al-ghazwa when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there and Sariya when he's not. No, this is the istilah of the ulama of tariq. Why? Because it makes it easier to know. So in this terminology, and the reason I made this clarification, because sometimes you hear about a ghazwa that would happen close to the Day of Judgment. And some ignorant people think, oh, that means the Prophet ﷺ will be there. No, that's not what it means. Ghazwa, it means a battle, a fight. You know, ghazwa. But in the terminology used by the ulama of tariq, just to make it easier, they would call a ghazwa when Rasulullah ﷺ was himself present. When he himself took part in a battle, or a raid, or a campaign, or expedition, then they would call it al-ghazwa. And al-ghazwa is the jama'ah, is the plural for ghazwa. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not there, but he sent the sahaba, radiallahu anhum, we call that al-sariya. Sariya, yani, this is a battle, an expedition, somebody sent out. But it is without Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the plural for that is saraya. Saraya is plural for sariya, which are the same thing, except the Prophet ﷺ is not present with them, with the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Now again, this is just terminology developed by the ulama of hadith. This is not like it's in the Quran, it has to be this way, or a hadith that it has to be this way. No. But this is terminology of the ulama of tariq. So we will have now 8 battles before Badr. 8. Now not every battle will have fighting in it. Understand something. Many times you will go out for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and return without a single arrow being fired, without the sword being drawn, but you have your niyyah. You have your intention. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks for. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the Sahih Hadith that the one who has a sincere intention for shahada, for martyrdom, he will die a shaheed. If somebody really, and I mean, you know, a sincere intention, not like, you know, I'm making intention and then you're, you know, going to the bar. You know, when you have a sincere intention, you do what you can, but you never fight a day, you die in your bed. At home, you will get the level of a shaheed. Because the niyyah. But again, sincerity is the key there. So there will be 8. There is Sayf al-Bahr, which is in Ramadan, first year of Hijrah. Many of the battles you will find will be in Ramadan. This is the month that you're fasting, but that doesn't mean it's a month you're sleeping all day. This is the month many of the battles will happen in. And many of the Sahaba will be fasting in the hot sun, in the desert. In this battle, there will be 300 of the Mushrikeen against only 30 of the Muslims. And even though there won't be much fighting in many of these, but I want you to look at something. That the Muslims here, in most of these, are very few. 30 against 300. And even then, the Mushrikeen will be running. This is the rock. This is why the Prophet ﷺ told us about the five things that were given to him and to this ummah that were not given to the ummah before. And one of them is the ru'b, that from a distance of a month's journey, the enemy will run from the ru'b of the Muslim. From the awe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in the hearts of the mushrikeen from the believer. The second is the sariya of Ubaidah ibn Harith. And here it will be 60 Muslims against 200 mushrikeen. The next is the sariya of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu. And here there will be 100 or there will be 20, only 20 Muslims against over 100 of the mushrikeen. And then there will be the ghazwa where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will himself go of Abwa. And this will be when around 100 Muslims. Then there will be the next ghazwa of Buwat. This is again where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will go, and then As-Safwan, and then al-ghazwa of Ushayra, and then al-Nakhla, and then we'll get to the Badr. Badr al-Kubra, as some of the ulama have said, the big Badr, and we'll explain why. Before we move forward, just want to talk a little bit about ghazwa and Saraya, when Rasulullah sent expeditions or he himself went. According to Imam al-Bukhari, and this is not in Sahih al-Bukhari, but rather in the Tarikh of Imam al-Bukhari, he felt that there were 70 ghazwa, 17. 17 battles that the Prophet ﷺ himself participated in. According to Imam Muslim, in his calculation there were 19. Imam al-Hakim, he says 21. What I found to be the strongest after looking at the different books of Tariq is the opinion of Ibn Ishaq. Imam Ibn Ishaq, one of the earliest scholars to write a book on Seerah, and one of the strongest ulama with the shortest asanid. When you come to the tafrij or checking of ahadith, you look at his asanid, some of them, there are only two or three narrators between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Hisham, his work is based on the works of Ibn Ishaq. So Ibn Ishaq, even though he has many da'if hadith as well, I'm not saying that everything he wrote was authentic, that's why he gives the sanad for the later ulama to check. But he records 27 ghazwa, and I think this to be the strongest. And he records 47 saraya, 47 battles where sahaba took place with the sahaba, without Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then 27 where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself went and fought. This is very important for us to understand, because our Prophet ﷺ is a complete example for us. You know, if you take Buddha, for example, according to many historians, a great personality. You know, there are many Buddhas actually, there wasn't one. You know, there's the skinny and the big one, mashallah. I don't know if he ate a lot later. Anyway, but he is a role model to people in certain aspects of life. To those who take him as a role model, no doubt in maybe humbleness or leaving the dunya, leaving kingdom and living with the poor, okay. But can you take him as a role model in how to lead a government? No, he left the government. What about in a commander in army? No. What about as a perfect husband? No, he left marriage and things. What about how to raise children? No. What about how to have daily prayers? He didn't explain it. That's why you see Buddhists in Tibet with Dalai Lama and whatever. Their prayer is very different from the Buddhists that are massacring Muslims in Burma, from the Buddhists in Thailand, from the some Buddhists. To them, the elephant is everything. You go to Thailand, you can't make fun of elephant, you can't touch elephant, because according to their Buddhism, the elephant is the holiest of animals. But in Tibet, the Buddhists don't care about the elephant. They don't even know what elephant is. They live in mountains. But the Prophet ﷺ, he showed us an example in every aspect of life. He wasn't a coward. He wasn't somebody that sat around and said, today I want to see Obama or Bush go out and grab a gun and stand in the battlefield. You won't see it. They're sitting behind their little security and bulletproof glass and this and that and that and just pressing buttons and making phone calls. And that's why it's so easy for these Congress people and senators to send the soldiers in battle, because they're not going themselves. So they can talk hawkish, but when it comes themselves, they're sitting there in their protected planes and protected bunkers and oval offices and places. But the Prophet ﷺ, he wouldn't put the Sahaba in a situation that he was afraid to go himself. The Prophet ﷺ, the first of these battles, it's called Sayf al-Bahr. And this was in the first of Ramadan, in the first year of Hijri, and according to the solar calendar, that would be 623. Who was made the Amir? And this is very important. We're learning here. If the Prophet ﷺ himself wasn't going, he would assign an Amir. And that's how we should learn to live our life. If we are going to send a jama'ah somewhere, you should assign an Amir. This is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said about the people, if there are three people, they don't have an Amir, then shaitan is their Amir. But today we've lost the sunnah. Even if you look at the so-called Muslim organizations and Muslim movements, if they're going to send a delegation, you're like, who's the Amir? What? What are you talking about? This is our minister of this, and this is our, you know, whatever of whatever. But they left the sunnah. But the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to make an Amir. So who was the Amir? That's interesting. When we have the Islamic Jeopardy, when I ask this question, the first Amir of the first expedition ever sent out for the Muslims, who was it? Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of Rasulullah, the lion of Allah, the great Sahabi. And it's very important for us to know this, because when we talk about Wahshi and Uhud and what happened and how the Prophet controlled himself, we need to know who Hamza radiallahu anhu was to know the hurt the Prophet felt in Uhud. So Hamza radiallahu anhu, he's made the Amir. And he takes 30 and only from the Muhajireen. Why from the Muhajireen? Why not Ansar? Because here, whose money and whose wealth has been confiscated? The Muhajireen. This isn't a battle yet. This is just to put raw. Just to say, hey, look, it's not that we can't defend ourselves. Because we're being patient, don't mistake it for weakness. And this is something in human nature. You know, this is what you study in books, and then there's what you see in life. Experience teaches you. And I've learned this through experience, through school, and middle school, and high school, that humans take niceness for weakness. When you're very nice, people think you're weak. I don't know why. You know, somebody wants to control themselves, people don't want to let them. So here the Prophet ﷺ is giving the Quraysh a message that don't mistake our niceness, our control, our love for peace for weakness. So here he sends Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib with 30 of the Muhajireen, and they go out against 300 of the Quraysh. The Quraysh, they have 300, and it's being led by Abu Jahl. And Abu Jahl is prepared to fight because he knows that they're going past Medina. And here, when they meet the Sahaba, radiyallahu anhum, even though they're only 30 against 300, one against 10, and they're not as well equipped, but they're ready to fight. And they're not initiating a fight, because Muslims never like to initiate violence. But they're saying, look, we're going to defend our property, so don't do this. But at that time, there is a man, his name is Majdi ibn Amr. Majdi ibn Amr was not a Muslim, but he was on good terms with the Muslims. And he was on good terms with Quraysh. And he was there in the area, and he came, and he made a sulh between them, and he made a pact. And the Muslims, because they didn't want to fight, they didn't want to spill blood, they accepted this, and they went back. But now the Quraysh, they got a message that the Muslims are men. The Muslims are not cowards. They are there to defend themselves. So now they could have taken a path to peace. It was a beautiful path, opening for peace. The Quraysh could have said,
you know what? The Muslims are defending themselves. We are wrong. We're doing something wrong anyway. We're taking somebody else's property. It's not ours. The Muslims are not taking our property. The Muslims didn't take anything from the Mushrikeen. But here the Quraysh are illegally, even according to their own laws, taking the property of the Muslims. They could have turned to peace, but they didn't. Instead, they stayed arrogant and they continued on their dhulm. Some other things to understand about this. So the Prophet ﷺ, he gave the flag of Islam. Islam teaches us ways of battle as well. So one thing we learn to make an Amir. Second, to have somebody carry a flag. And this man is going to be always be a very important man, because the way the battles happened back then is when the flag was raised, the army knew where to gather and where their strength was. And if the flag fell, the morale would fall, they wouldn't know where to come together, and everything would fall. We would lose. So here, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave the flag to Kanaz radiallahu anhu. Kanaz ibn Hussein, he is, it was called Abu Martad. Abu Martad. And he, his name is Kanaz ibn Hussein. Even though we don't know him much today, Abu Martad, when you look up his history, as I looked up before the Dars, he was a great Sahabi, a very brave Sahabi, a very close Sahabi to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he was entrusted with the flag of Islam in the first expedition. But what's very sad is we don't know him today. We don't know his history today. We don't know his contribution towards Islam today. But he was the one giving the flag, and he held the flag, and because there was no battle, nobody became shaheed, none of the mushrikeen were killed, but the message was given, and the Sahaba, they came back. And only a month afterwards, this was in Ramadan, in the first Hijri, only a month after that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent the Sahaba again, in Shawwal, in the month after Ramadan, in the first Hijri, he sent Ubaidah ibn al-Harith radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him, and Ubaidah ibn al-Harith, he is Ubaidah ibn al-Harith ibn al-Muttalib. Muttalib is the uncle, the one after who Abdul Muttalib was named after. And al-Harith was the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so he is the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a great Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him with 60 furqan. Furqan, يعني the Muslims riding on horses. When the warrior would ride on a horse, the Arab would call him furqan. So the furqan, they were all muhajirin again, none of the Ansar. Why? Because this is not a battle for Islam yet. This is just the muhajirin giving a message that look, you are oppressing the Muslims. You are oppressing us. You're taking our wealth, we're going to defend it. So he was sent to encounter Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan, who later became Muslim, but at this time was not a Muslim. And Abu Sufyan has with him 200 of the Quraysh. And he has with him a lot of wealth. And he goes to an area called Batan Rabir. Batan Rabir was an area. And this is where the Muslims and the Kuffar, they came face to face. Now how many Muslims? Only 60. How many of the Kuffar? 200. Now here, when the Muslims met them, they didn't attack. But when the Kuffar started shooting arrows, the first arrow that was ever shot, fi sabilillah, was shot here. The Muslims retaliated by shooting arrows. They weren't aggressive, but they stood their ground. Now, for everybody, we're going to be in Islamic jeopardy someday. Who was the first person to ever shoot an arrow for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu. As the Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab in his Mukhtasar al-Sirah, he says, أول من رمي بسهم في سبيل الله Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu. Now where arrows were exchanged, but the Quraysh, they ran. Even though they were more in number, very quick, 200, but they ran. And the Muslims, They let them go. Because the Muslims are always looking for a way of peace. They were not there to attack and raid. They were only there to tell them, look, we're here to defend ourselves. Don't do zulm. Stop. But here, the Quraysh, they didn't stop their zulm. They continued. So then, in Dhul Qa'dah, in the first of Hijri, again, which is translated to May 623 in the solar calendar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, the same Sahabi who was the first one to shoot the arrow. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him with 20 fursan, and again from the Muhajireen to Al-Kharrar. Al-Kharrar was an area close to Al-Hijaz, yani within Hijaz today. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent them against the Quraysh. When the Quraysh heard, even though there were more than 100, when the Quraysh heard that 20 fursan of the Muslims are coming, they left. And by the time the Muslims got them, the Quraysh had left. So once again, there was no fighting. But the Quraysh showed their cowardice, and the Muslims showed how brave they were. The flag, again, in all of these battles, the flags were white flags. I know in the West, they take the white flag as a flag of surrender, but this is a Western idea, it's not a Muslim idea. The flag of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the flag of Islam, in the most of these battles would be a white flag. And this time the flag was carried by Al-Miqdar ibn Amr. Al-Miqdar ibn Amr, my amazing Sahaba. I wanted to get into the biography of every one of them, but I realized it would stretch the durus very long. So I will just mention the names, and inshallah the brothers and sisters will be encouraged that if you don't know about these Sahaba, Al-Kunnaz, Al-Miqdar, then go learn about them on your own. Because they are examples for us. Again, the Quraysh, even after this third Sariya, they didn't stop their dhulam. They continued their dhulam. And here we have the first Ghazwa, the first battle where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself went and took part in. And this is the Ghazwa, Ghazwatul Abwa. Abwa is an area, it's also called Waddan, it's also been called the Ghazwa Waddan, but in the majority of the books of Tariqh, it's called Ghazwatul Abwa. And this is the first time that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself went. And the hadith for this, in all eight that I'm mentioning here, Ibn Hisham has, Ibn Kathir has, Muhammad Abdul Wahhab and Muqtasar Sirah has mentioned, and Adil Ulama have mentioned, but many of these are also in other books of hadith, like this is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari. In Sahih al-Bukhari, in hadith number 3949 is also in the hadith number 4404. In Sahih Bukhari, this is mentioned that this was in a Safar in the second year after Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the first year after Hijrah is finished, the second year has begun, which is 623 in the solar calendar. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself took 70 men, all Muhajireen. All from Muhajireen, 70 of them, with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he went out. But now, some new masail come up. Before, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made an ameer and he was taking care of Medina. But now, who is the ameer of the army? Of course, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. And I want to point something out. Even in these battles where there's no fighting, it's a lot of hardship. Because other than 15 days of travel, of going out, of being constantly on the alert, keeping guard, having not enough provisions, you know, hard environment. So it's still a difficult endeavor. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now has the issue of who to leave in charge and who to give the flag of Islam, because now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself is there. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he assigned Sa'd ibn Ubadah. Sa'd ibn Ubadah, the great Sahabi from the Ansar, he's the first one ever to be made an Amir in Medina after the Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I know many of us know about Ibn Umar al-Maktum, But before him, Sa'ad ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu, he was made the Amir of Medina, in charge of Medina, while Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself went. Who was given the flag? Hamza. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib radiallahu anhu. The Lion of Allah, he was given the flag of Islam. And again, it was a white flag, as Ibn Hisham has described. Now when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went himself, the Quraysh, they ran away again. When they heard about the Muslims coming, they changed the direction they ran. And it's not like they want peace, they're still making gunam. They're still taking that wealth. But they're afraid to fight, because they're cowards. But what did the Prophet ﷺ accomplish on this task? Other than to continue that pressure on the Quraysh, he made peace treaties with the mushrikeen of the areas he went to. SubhanAllah! Look at our Prophet ﷺ. Even when he's going out for battles, he's making peace. He made a peace treaty with Amr, and he is Makhshi. Amr ibn al-Makhshi al-Damiri, and this is a tribe they call Banu Damra. Banu Damra were a very strong tribe. They were not Muslims, but Amr was their leader. And when he saw the Muslims, and he saw their good akhlaq, and he saw the Quraysh and the dhulam they were doing, he came to the Muslims, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a treaty with them. And the treaty with them was safety for each other. First thing, the Banu Damra, if they were to go to the Muslim land, the Muslims would give them security. And if the Muslims were to go to their land, they would be secure. Peace. Secondly, as long as Banu Damra did not oppose the laws of Allah, they did not oppose the religion of Allah, they would have no conflict with the Muslims. They would be at peace with the Muslims, and the Muslims would support them. And if they were ever in a battle, the Muslims would support them. And if the Muslims were ever in a battle, Banu Damra would also support the Muslims. Like the treaty made with the Yahud. And these are very important, because those that violate the treaty, then there is punishment to violation. Here, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he met with them, made peace with them, and he came back. The fourth is also a ghazwa, and it's called Ghazwatul Buwaq. Buwaq, this is again an area. And in this ghazwa, this is in Rabiul Awwal, in the second year of Hijri, 623 in the solar calendar, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took 200 of the Sahaba. 200 Sahaba with him. And they went out because they knew that Umayyah ibn Khalaf, the enemy of Islam, the enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was with the Quraysh, and there was 100 men with him, and 2,500 camels. So that's a huge amount of wealth. And he was going, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took the Sahaba to meet them. And when he went out there, he left Sa'ad ibn al-Ma'ad, Sa'ad ibn al-Ma'ad, رضي الله عنه, the Ansari, in charge of Medina. The flag of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was again a white flag. It was taken with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he went out at this time, there was no fighting again. Umayyah ibn Khalaf, when he heard, he left, he changed directions, and when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got to Buwaq, Umayyah was not there, and there was no fight. But after this, what happened? If there is a mushrik, Qais ibn Jabir. Qais ibn Jabir is a mushrik. What did he do? He took some mushrikeen, and he attacked the outskirts of Medina. Now subhanAllah, you look at the Muslims, and how much constraint they're showing. Till now, they have not killed a single Muslim. They have not taken even their own property back from the mushrikeen. They have not taken a single camel, a single cow, a single goat, a single piece of clothing. Even their own wealth that was being taken by the mushrikeen of Mecca and being sold, even that they haven't taken back. And look at the mushrikeen and their oppression, their zulm. that not only are they taking the health of the Muslims that they left in Mecca, but now they're attacking Medina. Thus, Ibn Jabir, this mushrik, what did he do? He attacked an outskirt where they were just villagers, women and old men. And he took their wealth, and he took their livestock, their animals, cows and goats and camels. And he didn't even fight the Muslims. He didn't enter Medina. He just did this raid like a bandit, like a thief, like a coward, and ran. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent out the Sahaba to find him, to bring him to justice. And this was also called Al-Ghazwa. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went with them. And this expedition to find Fars ibn al-Har ibn al-Jabir is also called Badr al-Ula. Because the place where they found is called Safwan, and this comes under the area that's called Badr. But this is not the major Badr. The battle of Badr, the major battle, this is not it. But because it's the same place, it's called Badr al-Ula or Badr al-Sughra. And then the real battle of Badr is called Badr al-Kubra or Badr al-Thani. So here, the Sahaba, they went out against him and they went to look for him. And Zayd bin Harith, radiallahu anhu, was left as in charge of Medina. Now look at this. Sometimes the Prophet left the Ansar as in charge. And sometimes the Muhajireen, to show there's no difference. The Muslims are one body. Zayd bin Harith was left as the Amir of Medina. The white flag, that was the flag of Islam, that was carried by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the Amir, it's a ghazwa, he went out himself. But who carried the flag? The great Sahabi, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. And again, when the Sahaba, they went out, 70 of them, looking for him, Qars ibn Jabir, what did he do? He ran. He hid. He wasn't even the man enough to face the battle. Even though he had a large amount of mushrikeen with him, but he ran as a coward. And this was the fifth and the sixth of what happened. Then there is the Ghazwatul Ushira. And this is again with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Rahiq al-Maktum of Sheikh Mubarak Puri, one of the amazing books in Sira. In the book that I have from it, it mentioned that this was in Jamad al-Ula. But after researching it in the original books, like Ibn Hisham, Ibn Ishaq, in the Seerah of Ibn Kathir, the works of Muhammad ibn al-Wahhab on Seerah, and other important works, I found this to be in Jamad al-Akhir. Jamad al-Akhir. So I'm not sure if this is a mistake in print, or if it's a mistake by the scholar, but the classic books all mention this to be Jumad al-Akhir, in the second year of Hijrah, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took 150. Some of the books mention 200 of the Muslims, and it was only volunteers. And this is not a jihad that was fard al-ayn, whoever wanted to go. And here, because Medina had been attacked now, what happened? Medina was attacked by Qars ibn Jabir. So now, the Muhajireen and the Ansar were united in this battle. In the beginning, the Rasul alayhi salam, from his hikmah, he didn't involve the Ansar because they were not wronged by the Quraysh yet. This was only to stop the oppression of Quraysh. This is not a battle for the Shahada yet. So now, but now that Medina has been attacked, there were the Ansar as well. In this battle, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took from the Muhajireen and the Ansar, and they went out to catch the Quraysh again. And the Quraysh, again, even though they were huge in number, and many more with their weaponry and their wealth, but they ran away, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, again, he made treaties. He made peace treaties again. And he went, what's called the Wa'd. or the promise of Banu Madlij. Madlij, Banu Madlij, a major Arab tribe, and they were friends of Banu Damra, who Rasulullah also made treaties with. And by seeing how true the Muslims were to their treaty and what great akhlaq the Muslims had, these mushrikeen, who were people of shirk, they made peace treaties with the Muslims. Now these are very important, because when the major battles begin, the Quraysh will try to get every single mushrik Arab on their side. And because of these peace treaties, many of those tribes will not participate in those battles. So these were great victories for Islam, even if there was no fighting here. Here, who was left in charge of Medina? Here's Abu Salama, who is one of the brothers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Rada. Abu Salama here, he is the son of Abdul Asad, and he is from the brothers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but not through blood lineage, through suckling, through having the same woman breastfeed both of them. So through Rada, he is the brother of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Abu Salama radiallahu anhu was left in charge of Medina while Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went out. Now, we look at the hikmah behind a lot of these, and you realize the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was teaching the Sahaba a lot of things in these. One, the importance of making peace treaties. And this is something the Muslims many times, especially in history, will forget. That they will just think it's us and that's it, everybody else is against us, let's kill everybody. No, that's not the way it is. The Prophet ﷺ always wanted to make peace. And when there is benefit for the Muslims in making a treaty of peace, there is permission to do so. And here Rasulullah ﷺ did so. Now, these were seven. Now we get to the eighth, and the final before Badr. And this is the expedition of Abdullah ibn Jahsh. Abdullah ibn Jahsh, radiallahu anhu, the great famous Sahabi, to a place called Nakhla. And this area of Nakhla is a very important area in history. We'll discuss about it later. This was in Rajab, in the month of Rajab, in the second year of Hijri. We'll translate to January 624. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent Abdullah ibn Jahsh radiallahu anhu to Nakhla, and he was given with him 12 muhajireen, only 12 men, and they only had 6 camels. How many camels? Only 6 camels, 12 men. And what does that mean? That they would take turns. One would ride and one would walk, and then he would ride and the other would walk. And even the Amir, he would take turns. And look at the tawadu, look at the humbleness, and look at the love for each other. That they would offer each other their own turn. And through a lot of hardships, they went out. But when they went out, they had no idea what they were going out for. This is a very important point. The Prophet ﷺ gave Abdullah ibn Jahsh a letter. And he told him, don't open this until you are 2 days of travel. For 2 days travel without even opening this letter. It's very important. What does this tell us? Sometimes, you don't need to tell everybody everything. You know, this is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would tell somebody something when they needed to know it at the time they needed to know it. Now here, none of the Sahaba in Medina know where these Sahaba are going. Imagine, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, they don't know. Were they upset? Whoa, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why are you keeping secrets from us? No, they didn't need to know. It was on a need to know basis. So the Prophet ﷺ, he wrote this letter and he gave the mission to Abdullah bin Jahsh without telling anybody in Medina and without even Abdullah bin Jahsh knowing. And he told him 2 days of travel in this direction, then opened the letter. Why? Because they were spies. Even the trusted Sahaba were not told because maybe they'd be having a conversation and a munafiq would hear it. Maybe they would be preparing something for battle, and Abu Natif would find out and take the news to Quraysh. And there were spies on both sides. There was espionage going on. There were Muslims that were living with the Quraysh, like the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abbas radiallahu anhu. Abbas radiallahu anhu was living as a mushrik, even though he became a Muslim. His Islam was secret for a long time. Even in Badr, he's a Muslim, but nobody knows it. And he's bringing news. He's getting news to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the mushrikeen of Quraysh, they have the munafiqun, the hypocrites of Medina, taking news to them, to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of his hikmah. And out of a very important point that we should learn. He didn't tell anybody, even the Amir of the expedition didn't know. 2 days later, he opens the letter and he's told to go to Nakhla, a place between Makkah and Ta'if. And he's told that this is where the Quraysh are going to be, and to go and intimidate them. Go and put this rock on them. Now Abdullah bin Jahsh knows that this is the month of Rajab. And the month of Rajab, as we discussed, is one of the 4 holy months that Allah has made sacred, that you shouldn't fight during that time. And this is something that was made sacred by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And the Quraysh knew about this, the Arab knew about this, and the Quran confirmed it. So he didn't want to fight. But he went because even though they don't want to fight, but they have to defend their property. They have to put that fear. So they went and they found the Quraysh there. And who was there? Amr ibn al-Hadrami. Amr ibn al-Hadrami was a mushrik, an enemy of Islam, a very bad man. And Uthman and Nawfal, the sons of Abdullah al-Mughayra. Abdullah ibn al-Mughayra, enemy of Islam, his son Uthman and Nawfal are there. Al-Hakam ibn al-Kaysan, again one of the staunch enemies, a freed slave of the Quraysh, but an enemy of Islam. So these enemies of Islam, they are there with goods that are part of which belong to the Muslims. And there were raisins, and there were food, and there were many valuable goods with them. Abdullah ibn Jahsh, he made shura. He made what? He made the shura. This is the way of the Muslims. He's an Amir. He asked for opinions of the other Sahaba, the 12 men with him. He said, what should we do? This is our wealth, and they're taking it. And we have an opportunity. The Quraysh are many, but they are not so many. So if we want, let us take this back with us. For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, take our wealth back with us. Because they're attacking Medina, they're taking our wealth. They're taking animals. They're taking the wealth that we have in Makkah and selling it. Let's take it. And they agreed to do it. How did they agree? It doesn't mean they took a vote and everybody raised their hand or put ballots. No. They gave opinions. Abdullah bin Jahsh, he made a decision, and they followed the decision. So they attacked them and they killed Amr ibn Hadrami. The mushrik, the kafir, he was killed. And they took Uthman and Nawfal and others as prisoners. And they took the wealth as ghanima. And they went back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now when they came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not happy with this. Why? Because the first thing is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves peace. He didn't want blood to be spilled. He just wanted Quraysh to stop. But the Quraysh wouldn't. The second thing is, it was a month of Rajab. A month that you're not supposed to fight with it. But Abdullah bin Jahsh, he made ijtihad. He said that what they're doing, the zulm they're doing to us is worse than fighting in these months. So he made ijtihad. So even though the Prophet ﷺ was not happy about it, he didn't punish Abdullah bin Jahsh. Why? He said, because you made shura. You consulted the Sahaba. And you were the Amir. And you made a face along with the shura, there is no harm upon you. And this tells us something. That when we follow the sunnah, and we make a shura, and we have a faisal, somebody make a decision, and a decision is made, even if it's a wrong decision, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish us for it. As long as we follow the correct path. So here, Amr ibn al-Hadrami is killed, Uthman and Nawfal and others are taken as prisoners, but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not happy. And the Quraysh, they start a PR campaign now. They start telling all the Arab, look, these Muslims, they're fighting in the holy month. They call them holy months, but look at them. This is the way of the Kafir, always trying to degrade the Muslim. Always trying, they're not talking about the bullying they're doing, that they're attacking Medina, that they're taking the wrath of the believers, they're imprisoning and torturing and killing. Here they've already killed Yasir radiallahu and Sumayya radiallahu and many Muslims. In Zulum, they don't take care about that, but if the Muslim just defends their own wealth in the holy month, oh, look at them. The same thing that will go on today. How many Arab kuffar are killing, how many Arab Muslims? The Muslims being massacred in Burma and Kashmir, all these places, nobody's talking about it. Oh, that's no problem. But if some Muslim even raises their voice to defend Islam, oh, look at him, he's an extremist, he's this. And the Muslims are the first ones to attack. And this is what we see, the Munafiqun, who call themselves Muslims in Medina, they were the first ones to start causing a problem about this. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed ayat in the Quran and freed Abdullah bin Jahsh from any blame. And he told them that those that ask you about fighting in the holy month, they know that the dhulam that is happening upon them, those that are being kicked out from their own home, from Masjid al-Haram, those that are being oppressed, that oppression is worse than fighting in the holy month. Which tells us that if somebody is dhulam, then to defend yourself against dhulam, even in the holy month is allowed. Because a Muslim should never be mazlum. He should never be oppressed. He should stand up for himself. It's sad to see the Muslims today. You see some of them, when the Babri Masjid was being destroyed in India, we saw some of the Muslims crying, rubbing the Masjid stones, begging, what are you doing? Stand up! Be a man! Defend yourself! Because how long is your begging? Nobody's going to care. How long have the people of Tibet been protesting in the streets and free Tibet, free Tibet? China doesn't care! Protest all he likes. Dalai Lama sitting there having tea with the Queen, his people are being killed, nobody cares! You have to stand for yourself. You have to defend yourself. And that's what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us in the seerah. And when this happened, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a man of peace, as a man of great restraint, he even paid the blood money for Amr ibn al-Hadrami, even though he didn't deserve it. But to show the best of akhlaq, and to show that the Muslims are never aggressors, they're never oppressors, he even paid the blood money for Amr ibn al-Hadrami. And he freed Uthman and Nawfal ibn al-Abdullah al-Mughayrah. He freed them. Even though the Quraysh didn't buy their freedom, he freed them. To show the good akhlaq of the Muslim. A Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he talks about this incident in his Muftasar al-Sirah, and he says that the mushrikeen, they were causing a fitna. And what is fitna? He says, not only were they attacking the Muslims and causing problems amongst the Muslims and the problem for the Muslims in Medina, but the fitna they were causing was shirk. That's a very deep thing to think about. Because when you look at it from a historical perspective, you realize the fitna that the Quraysh were causing by causing problems in Medina, by causing the mushrikeen of the Arab to boycott the Muslims, financial fitna, by attacking Medina, by taking the wealth of the Muslims. But another fitna is their shirk. Because shirk, it divides people. Humanity was meant to be united on Tawheed. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted for humanity. And when shirk begins, then somebody makes a religion to do worship a cow, somebody worships a man, somebody worships a snake, somebody worships nature, somebody worships a spirit, somebody worships a tree. You divide mankind, you cause fitna. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to unite mankind on the worship of the one true Allah. And this is when the Muslims were told to fight against this fitna. And here begins the preparation for another raid. There is a caravan of the mushrikeen, of the Quraysh. And this caravan, as many of the historians have said, the Muslims knew for 100% that it had physical goods that were taken from their houses in Mecca. And they were being taken to Sham to be sold. The property of the Muslims. And the Prophet ﷺ, he decided to make it a ghazwa and go himself. And he collected some of the Sahaba, not preparing for a battle. Just for one of the ghazwat, as we've seen, where some maybe a person is shot with an arrow, or maybe there will be some problem, but nothing big. So that type of preparation came, knowing that Abu Sufyan had 50,000 dinar, gold dinar. From the wealth of the Muslims, 50,000 gold dinar. That he had with him 40 men. And he had many of the physical goods that were taken from the houses of the Muslims. So here the Prophet ﷺ gathered about 300 Sahaba. Some of the books of Tariq, they mention 313, some mention 317, but between 300 and 317. But they were not ready for a battle. They were expecting to go up against how many people? 40 men. So what was their preparation? Very light. Whatever weapons they could find. Some of the books they say they took sticks and stuff, but that's not authentically reported anywhere. They took swords, they took spears, they weren't idiots. They're not gonna go into a battle with like, you know, a branch of a tree. What are you gonna do? But they weren't prepared with armor and weaponry and lot of, you know, they had 82 to 86 of the Muhajirin, and the rest were Ansar, 61 of them from Aus, 170 from Khazraj, equaling between 300 to 317 of them. They only had two horses. The whole campaign only had two horses. One belonging to Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, the great Sahabi, one of the 10 giving the glad tidings of Jannah. And the second horse belonging to Mandar ibn al-Aswad, another great Sahabi we spoke about earlier. So only two horses. And they only had 70 camels. So between about 300 Sahaba, they had 70 camels. So they would have a rotation of almost three people. One person would sit, and then he would get off. Another person would sit, and then he would get off. And a third person would sit, and then he would get off. And then somebody would get their turn. So it shows the very harsh circumstances. So only these many Sahaba, and only this much of a preparation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself is on a rotation for his camp. Between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu and Murtad radiallahu anhu. So these three are taking a rotation of their own. Even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is on a rotation for two out of three turns he's walking. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left Medina, and according to the Sunnah, he left a person in charge of Medina. And who was made in charge of Medina? Ibn Umm al-Makhtum radiallahu anhu. Ibn Umm al-Makhtum radiallahu anhu is a Sahabi who's blind. And he's of very old age. And that's why later, Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu was made Amir, and we'll discuss that later. Who is taking the flag of Islam? Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu. Mus'ab ibn Umayr, the young Sahabi, very young Sahabi, he's taking the flag of Islam. And there are two battalions made, two sections of the army. One is the Ansar and one is the Muhajirin. And what does that tell you? It doesn't mean there's nationalism. They're all together. But when you have, for example, if you bring a battalion of the Muslims today, and they're Afghan, or they're Arab, or they are Urumu, and they come together, nothing wrong with that. As long as they are united together in their call, in their tawheed, in their banner, their hearts are united. So here, the Muhajireen are being led by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu, and the Ansar by Sa'd bin Mu'adh radiallahu anhu. And then they're making flanks. The right flank is being led by Zubair ibn al-Awwam, and the left by Miqdad ibn Amr. in the rear by Al-Qais radiallahu anhu, is Qais ibn al-Sa'sa. Qais ibn al-Sa'sa radiallahu anhu. And who is the leader of the army? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When they're coming out to face 40 men, this news from some of the munafiqeen got to the Quraysh. The Quraysh said, there are 300 of them, they only have 2 horses, only 70 camels, and they don't have armor, not a single armor. None of them armored soldiers. Just regular people. Let's take an opportunity. We're not going to fight them with equal numbers. We're going to ambush them with everything we have. So the Quraysh, they took 1,300 men. How many? 1,300 men. And 600 of them were professional soldier armor. Yani those that were trained and they were the soldiers of the Quraysh, that were the army of the Quraysh. With full armor. The Muslims don't have a single one like this. And they had 100 horses. How many horses? 100 horses. The Muslims only have 2 horses. And they went out to fight the Muslims. And the place where the battle would be Badr. The ambush is set. 40 men with Abu Sufyan are the bait. 300 Sahaba coming, but from the back, 1,300 mushrikeen of Quraysh with 600 armored soldiers, 100 horses coming to ambush the Muslims. And what happens, we'll find out next Saturday, inshallah ta'ala.
فَفِرُّوا